Just a few weeks ago at the University of Western in nearby London, Ontario, there were reports all across social media of up to 30 women having been drugged at Medway Sydenham Hall residence at the university campus. There were eyewitness reports of women helping girls that were completely incapacitated, staggering out of the residence, and there were even reports of sexual assault. Now, in the ensuing days, the London Police Services have claimed that no one has come forward to lodge a formal complaint, but in that time, it actually lodged 4 cases of sexual violence at the university, as well as a tragic case of an 18-year-old that was killed after an altercation in a nearby parking lot. And as a result, in the week after, the University of Western staged a walkout with 10,000 students and professors walking out in support of those victims of sexual violence and decrying the sort of state of misogyny that's rampant across university campuses. Sexual assault is still the most reported crime on campus. 1 in 5 women will experience some form of sexual violence while at university. In 2014, 41% of all sexual assault cases were reported at university. 90% of them were women. In fact, women under the age of 25 experienced the highest rate of sexual assault in the country. And most of this happens in the first 6 to 8 weeks of university, otherwise known as the red zone. In fact, 50% of all cases of sexual assault on campus happen in this red zone, a red zone that we're currently in right now. In 2021, a year after many first-year students maybe have deferred going to university till now, or have experienced a very unusual last year of high school, maybe without a prom or a formal, with a diminishment of house parties, and depending on their individual situation, perhaps locked up at home, hardly ever seeing friends, now suddenly free, out on their own and ready to party. To top it off, it's homecoming weekend here, where the two local rival universities face off against each other for some football shenanigans or rival sporting endeavors, whatever it is that homecomers do at homecoming. I'm not exactly sure. Most of the events are virtual in the hope that it can sort of quell any overabundance of partying, which seems a little optimistic considering in the first few weeks with the students coming back into town, we've seen parties and gatherings number up into the thousands. Anyway, it's in this environment that my daughter was recommended to check out Eternity Maris's debut memoir, They Said This Would Be Fun, which prompted me to pick it up as well. You see, my daughter is a don in residence, and I'm not exactly sure how ubiquitous that term is, but basically she is someone who is looking out for students living on campus on residence. And she has about 30 kids that she looks out for in a building of about 380. So there's quite a few dons there. They're basically just making sure that the kids aren't being dumb, trying to sneak people in to stay overnight, partying in their rooms, staying up and making too much noise late into the night, smoking in hallways. And I mean, they're going to get away with a lot of that stuff. They're still going to have fun, just as long as they're not stupid about it. Now, part of her responsibility is also one-on-ones with those 30 students. Just making sure that they're in a good headspace, they're adjusting well, they're doing okay as far as school, aware of the supports that are available to them, the clubs that are there at the school, and to make sure they're in a good headspace. And I think a lot of that headspace of first-year students and students in general is what Eternity is examining in her memoir. Eternity recounts her experience going to university in the very white London, Ontario, at the very white Western University, has garnered somewhat of a reputation as a party school. Eternity grew up in the very multicultural environs of Toronto. She grew up the daughter of an absent Jamaican father and a Pakistani mother. So she was raised Pakistani. She grew up eating curry, keema, nahari. So it's difficult for her parents to initially understand that the rest of the world sees her as black and that the racism that she experiences is very specifically to her as a black woman. And this is in the arguably progressive environs of a university, which seems to be mostly left and filled with woke social justice warriors, ready to cancel people, ready to invoke some social media-fueled flash mob activism in the face of any injustice, and yet still remain relatively indifferent to mundane, prosaic, everyday racism. And so Eternity talks about, again, being black at the university, the inevitable talks in class of slavery, and everyone in class, including the professor, turning to look to her to speak for an entire race, being tokenized by men who are looking to go black, being referred to as chocolate, ma, or ebony, friends looking for a pass to say the N-word as they sing along to their favorite rap song, blackface Halloween costumes, constant touching of her hair, to outright hostility and the very real threat of violence. But this memoir isn't just about her experience being Black on a campus. It's very intersectional, and it is talking about being female at the university. Again, echoed by a lot of the stuff that was happening at the University of Western this year. She talks about fraternities and how men who join fraternities are 3 times more likely to commit rape, and that women who join sororities are more likely to experience rape, and this rape culture that's rampant across universities, and how all these things are sort of dismissed as boys will be boys, and gosh, you don't want some sort of minor indiscretion to otherwise ruin a promising future, especially if they're an athlete of some sort. And that, you know, her experience with off-campus housing banners saying things like Queens girls spit, Western girls swallow, and no means yes, and yes means anal, and just having it being dismissed by people in authority is just kids being dumb. There's nothing at all. Beyond that, research has shown that like up to 9 universities in Canada have specific policies in place to prevent survivors about talking of their own sexual assault, and that up to 50% of women on campus have no idea, have never been educated on how to report a sexual assault. Eternity also talks about her own experience with intimate partner violence. This despite the fact that she was the president of the group leadership council, and she talked to the younger girls about recognizing dating violence, the red flags that they should look out for, despite the fact that she was completely oblivious to those same red flags with her boyfriend. This is a boyfriend that insisted she stop hanging out with her girlfriends because they were too headstrong and feminist. That, you know, she should not go to university. She should stay with him, get married, have kids. He would go to the point of even tampering with protection to make that happen. She would eventually go off to university, but he would call in the middle of the night and insist that she take her phone and scan it around her room to prove that she was by herself. And this would culminate in her showing up at her residence, waking her up in the middle of the night with a hammer just inches from her face. And she doesn't paint herself as this helpless victim, that this is all resolved when they eventually do break up and he finds another girlfriend. She finds herself still thinking about him, still wanting to reach out to him. She makes those same mistakes of a different sort with subsequent boyfriend and ignores all the red flags inherent there as well, and how this relationship had such a profound impact on how she perceives other subsequent relationships. It's also about growing apart from your best friend, the one that you went to school with, that were inseparable, but that you can also want different things in your life and slowly differ apart. This isn't a memoir. This is a deeply personal, long-form reporting of universities as a crucible for immense change and growth. I really did enjoy this read, not the least of which for a better understanding of what my daughter and my daughter's cohort is going through going to school, which she's having to contend with the first years that she's responsible for as a don in residence. I mean, it does seem like they are in the worst absolute timeline with climate change and partisanship and COVID, for crying out loud, plus all of this on top of it. Anyway, it is a little eye-opening, and yes, I'm a long way past having gone to university as an old guy, but I really did enjoy this read. They said this would be fun, well worth checking out for a little bit of insight as far as what are the millennials, Gen Z, etc. are going through right now at school. It is kind of never-ending for them, gosh. Anyway, that's it for me this week. I hope you all have a great week of reading, and we'll talk to you again soon.